Okay, hello, and thanks for joining us for this quick conversation. Today we're joined by Kerry, and we're going to be talking about the voice control feature on iPad. But before we get anywhere near that feature, Kerry, could you introduce yourself, please?
Hello, everyone. My name is Kerry Abercrombie. I am an Apple Distinguished Educator and also the Curriculum Development Officer for Digital Learning at Falkirk Council in Scotland.
Amazing. So Kerry and I have known each other for a little while now, and she always amazes me of her ideas and the way she uses technology in interesting and innovative ways. So I'm looking forward to this conversation a lot. No pressure at all. So the accessibility feature we're looking at is called voice control. Could you explain in a nutshell how voice control changes how the iPad works?
Yes, so voice control essentially does exactly what it says on the tin. It allows you to control your iPad with your voice. There are a list of sort of commands that it recognises, so it takes a little bit of time and a little bit of getting used to kind of figure out what the commands are. But once you have them mastered, it really unlocks so much potential with what you can do with your iPad.
I think that's interesting. It's not the kind of tool where you toggle a switch on and the screen changes colour and it becomes immediately accessible to everyone. There is the learning curve for this one.
I would say so, yeah.
How do you kind of navigate that learning curve when you first enable it?
I think it's just a case of practicing. It's like anything else. Just kind of practice with it. It's actually there's quite a lot of fun things that you can do with it and fun ways that you can practice. And I think once you've got a handle of it, you can then use those commands for a whole different range of apps and interfaces and all that sort of thing. So, yeah.
Well, I tell you what, before we get too far into the conversation, let's have a quick look at how we can enable it on our devices. And I'll show you the kind of the quick walkthrough guide as well in the settings app. So I'll quick look at that now. To enable this feature, all we need to do is jump into the settings app and then scroll down until we find accessibility. From here, we're looking for voice control under the physical and motor section of the settings. When you tap onto here, it's simply a case of using that toggle at the top of your screen to enable voice control. But before we leave this page, there are a couple of other things I want to draw your attention to. One of them is the overlay you can have on the screen itself. If I tap on here, I can choose to have a grid of numbers, or I can choose to label each button with its own unique number. We'll have a look at the item numbers in a second, but if I turn the grid on, this is what you'll see. And you can then simply navigate the iPad by using the number of that grid reference. I prefer using the numbers myself rather than the grid, so if we go back a screen, we can actually use the voice control guide at the top to learn a little bit about how this feature works. When we open this screen, we get this nice guide made by Apple that can show us what this feature is capable of. At the moment, you can still see that grid of lines over my screen, but we'll soon get rid of that and replace it with something which, for me personally, I find more useful. So, we're going to simply use our voice to begin this process. Click Getting Started. Throughout this guide, we're going to follow the instructions, and I'm going to do a little bit of it with you now. I won't do the whole thing, but just so you can get the idea of how this works. Show numbers. Tap 5. Tap 6. Scroll down. Scroll up. Tap 6. Swipe down. Go home. Go home. You can see that I can navigate that demo using my voice, but it works in other apps as well. For example, open App Store. Of course, I can choose to hide that overlay of numbers or show it so it hasn't always got to be on. Hide numbers. Show numbers. Tap 11. Tap 4. Tap 6. And just like that, I've used the App Store. You can see just what a powerful tool this is if physical interaction is difficult for you. Of course, we can turn this setting off as well. Let's do that using our voice just because we can. Go home. Open Settings. Tap 4. And now I've turned off that voice control feature. So as you can see, there's quite a lot of resources built into the Accessibility Settings app that will actually guide you through some of those initial commands that Kerry was talking about. In the demo, Kerry, I show kind of how to, you know, close an app, open the App Store, and then use the grid and the labels. Do you find that either grid or the labels, have you got a preference? Do you use both of them, either of them?
I prefer the grid.
Okay.
Just because it's more, for me, it's more visual. So I can see when I say, you know, enable grid, and then it comes up, I can then zoom into like different parts. I don't always necessarily know what the labels are going to be. So that for me is a little bit more stressful. I think just when you've got it blocked into a grid of 9 and then you can zoom into a grid further and then choose a specific part, that's a lot easier for me.
Yes, I think with the labels, if things move around the screen or you're used to 4 or within the back button, then suddenly it's 5. So there's that extra thinking time to work out what you're doing, whereas it's always in the same location, the particular button.
Yes.
So let's talk about how you would use this feature. I mean, I know you've mentioned to me privately you use it yourself for an interesting use. Could you elaborate?
So my first foray into voice control is actually based upon the fact that I'm a massive reader. But obviously in Scotland, it gets quite cold, particularly in the winter. So I was kind of finding that when I was reading with my physical books, I would cozy down in the duvet, but then I had to have my arms out to hold the book. So I invented what I call lazy girl reading. So I'll have my digital book open in books and I will put my iPad sort of next to me, arms in the blanket, all cozy. And then I'll just use swipe left, swipe left, swipe left, just to move through the pages, and it saves my arms from getting cold. So it was very much a sort of comfort-based approach that I was taking. But then once I had figured out that I could do that, I was like, hang on, what other things could I actually use this for? And being a media and English teacher, obviously one of the big things that immediately struck me was when you're filming alone or when you're filming maybe in small groups, and everybody has to be on screen, so you don't have a camera person. That ability to set up the iPad with the forward-facing camera so everyone can see, and then using voice control to start the recording and to stop the recording without having to kind of have that bit that you've always got to edit out where you run up to the camera and switch it off. I think that's like a really useful use for it as well.
It absolutely is. I hadn't actually thought of using it in that context, but that's a really good way of using it. I'm just going to come back to your lazy girl reading, because I think that's the perfect way of explaining how I learn new features. I'll find something and then I'll just play with it and try and find how this resonates with me. Can I fit it into my life? And I tend to learn things just by playing and exploring and poking around at things. And it sounds perhaps like you're similar in that sense.
Absolutely, like definitely. I'm always going, that's cool, but how will it serve me? How will it make my iPad better for me? How will it make my experience more user-friendly or more functional or faster or keep my arms warm or whatever it may be?
And I think that's actually a really good entry point for people watching this. Voice control, as we mentioned, it's not just an instant pick-up learn. You have to learn a bit. But actually, not being scared of it and trying to explore and just understanding how it works by trying it yourself as someone watching this, as an educator potentially, I think it's advisable they just try it. Try it and see what works.
Absolutely. And don't forget, if you get sick of it, you can always say turn off voice control and it will do it automatically without you having to press anything in settings. So you can switch it on in your settings and then you can switch it off at any time using your voice.
It really is one of those features that you almost have to pinch yourself when you think about how deeply it's integrated all the way across the iPad. And every single thing that you would use an iPad for, with your fingers or touching it or a trackpad or a mouse, everything is accessible through voice. And that opens up such an incredible way of using the device if you're someone who isn't able to interact with it in ways that perhaps you normally would. And I think as educators, if we don't know that this exists, then should we ever need it, we're not going to know how to support that learner. We're not going to know what to recommend. So actually taking a bit of time to explore features like this and to realize just how embedded across the whole iPad they are and how easy to use they are once you get the hang of it, it's time well spent, because you never know when it's going to come in handy. Not quite as good as your lazy girl reading, but I quite often use it. I'm cooking in the kitchen and I've got a recipe on the iPad. You got your hands covered in whatever you're cooking. And again, it's just finding ways to use it in your day-to-day life so it becomes normal to us as teachers, so we can then share it with others in the future if we needed to.
Absolutely, because it's that thing, isn't it, where you become proficient in the function, the application of it is the same across the board, whether it's at home baking, whether it's in your bed reading, whether it's in class making films, whatever it might be. It's just, like you say, like playing with it, getting used to it, and introducing it to learners so that they have it as an option in their toolkit as well, I think.
That's absolutely key. It should be an option that's available to everyone, and they can choose if they require it or need it or not. Kerry, yeah. Thank you so much for that quick conversation. I said it would be quick, and hopefully it was. I've learned loads from you about how you're using this, and I think we've come up with a strategy about actually getting people to switch it on and see what happens, and not to be afraid of tools like this, because they're there to help. So thank you so much for empowering people to do that and for sharing your wisdom. And it's been lovely talking to you.
You too. Thank you.